हरि ओम स्टार्ट द प्रेयर ओम समस्त जन कल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरं वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचानूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानंदं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं त्वमेव माता च पिता त्वमेव त्वमेव बंधुश्च सखा त्वमेव त्वमेव विद्या द्रविडं त्वमेव त्वमेव सर्वं मम देव देव त्वमेव सर्वं गुरुदेव देव हरि ओम वी आर लुकिंग एट दि स्टेजेस इन दि सेल्फ रियलाइजेशन एंड इन दैट देयर आर सेवन स्टेजेस नंबर वन इज दि अविद्या अज्ञानम एंड टू इज दि आवरण विच हैज टू पार्ट्स आवरण इज the Ishvara exists or not, Brahman exists or not, are the cause for the creation. We are talking about both the intelligent cause and the material cause for the creation. So Upadana Karana and Nimitta Karana. And only Vedanta addresses the material cause, because every religion says that God created the world. But God is an intelligent cause. But where did he get the material from the creation? So material itself has to come from him. So Lord himself is the whole universe itself. So the Vishwam is nothing but Vishnu only. And Vishwam, Vishnu Vashatkaro, Bhuta Bhavya Bhavat Prabhu. So the Vishnu Sahasrama starts saying that Vishnu is nothing but Vishnu. Vishwam is nothing but Vishnu. And that is essentially the Narayana itself. And that is the Avaranam of the existence, of the first avaranam. Second avaranam is, who am I? What's my nature? And what should be my relation to the world and to the Ishvara? All that is implied in the avaranam. And if I don't know, then I'll be suffering the consequence. So the prayojanam is emphasized. That means I understand now that I need to know, because I don't want to suffer the life after life after life. So this knowledge is important, not just for the knowledge sake, because it solves the fundamental human problem, and that is because of the suffering. That's called samsara, and that is called sokam, and that is the bhranti, because of the moham, because of the delusion that I am taking the what I see as a real and not knowing what is reality. And that's what is the problem of Arjuna. And after all the Bhagavad Gita, and he himself says, what happened? Have you gained the knowledge? Do you know what need to do? He says, Nashto Mohaspati Labda Tat Prasade Namayachyuta. Krishna says, Arjuna says that I have, the delusion is gone. And that is part of the third stage, where delusion is taking the illusion or the plurality as real and transacting the world. Because there is no problem in taking the reality, but this is only transactionally real. Things come and things go, continuously changing. I cannot hold on to it for my happiness, because it's going to change anyway. So only way is I have to be insulating enough, whether it comes or not, I should be happy. That should be the attitude, and that's what is called the bhranti, is the third stage, where I recognize the cause for the bhranti and go after the proper knowledge. And the proper knowledge, which is fourth knowledge, where I have to go to a teacher, and that is essentially the Parokshya Jnanam. So the fourth stage in the evolution is going for Vedanta Vichara, where for that I have to go to a teacher and learn. And what kind of teacher? Sotriyam Brahmanishtam, the one who has learned this scripture through a teacher. So not just an authority, someone is an authority, oh, he has realized, therefore he should be approached. So I cannot test whether somebody else realized or not. And you can have a belief that somebody has realized, and he might have realized also. It's not that question. But that cannot be a pramana. Even if he has realized, he cannot be pramana unless he himself has gone through a teaching and has learned the methodology of teaching, so that he knows what are the problems a disciple will go through, because he has gone through the same process. And therefore you have to approach an appropriate teacher who has gone through, that appeals to your mind, and your mind is able to anchor and says, I am getting benefit from this teacher. That's what is the litmus test is. Whether the teacher realized is not important, because if you are getting a benefit out of the teaching and you know that the teaching is not from his reference, from the scriptural reference. So shastrasya guruvakyasya. So not only just a teacher teaching anything out of his hand, but it is teaching what the scripture says. So right teacher is the one who refers disciple to go to the scripture, this is what the scripture, or teaches the scripture itself, and that is the right teacher, because what he says is supported by the logic and the scriptures and the logic and the experience also. So therefore the teacher is able to clear my doubts, and my doubts are very rational because I come from a very scientific background or a rational background. I cannot accept some belief system unless you prove me logically it is so, and therefore I cannot give up other things unless it is logically proved. And this is what actually happened to me when I started reading the J. Krishnamurti's statement, and he started teaching and reading the books itself, and he says your mind is conditioned because you are brought up in the environment, everything sounds logical. Yes, I agree that my mind is conditioned. Now what to do next? Decondition yourself. That's true. So what should I do next? Don't ask anymore what should I do next. Because if I give you a recipe to decondition myself, as if you follow Krishnamurti's teaching, then you are conditioned again to his teaching and you will not be unconditioned. You have to uncondition the mind. Then how do I uncondition my mind? Don't ask the how, because then you are looking for a process. I am up against the wall. It says, observe your mind. I tried to observe my mind, I got lost with the mind. Because for me to observe my mind, I need a vairagya. I need to detach my mind without getting attached and without getting hijacked by the thoughts that rise in the mind. It's not the thought problem. It's not thought. Thinking is not a problem. So people think that you should go beyond the thoughts. Doesn't mean that absence of the thought. Without the thoughts, you cannot see the consciousness, because consciousness cannot be seen. And says when you go beyond the thought, you become silent. You become silent is not a knowledge. Silent is you become, if teacher becomes a silent, if everything is silent, no knowledge will take place. So it's not the silence, because there's an observer of the silence. When the observer of silence has to know that what I am observing is, I am a conscious entity that is conscious of the absence of the thought. Absence of thought is not necessarily, is another object only. And absence of the thought and presence of the thought, both are objects only. And just like when I go to in the other room, he says, is there a chair there? I say, it's not, there's no chair there. So how do you know? He says, I see. You see what? I see the absence of chair. So absence of the chair, called Anupalabdhi Pramana, is also an object of knowledge, just as absence of not knowing is also, Ajnanam is also a knowledge only. I know that I don't know. That is in fact a first step for me to know. So absence of objective is also a silence. Silence is also an object of my observation. I am not the silence. I am that which is observing the silence. I am the consciousness that enlivening the silence. So silence is not a problem. It is my shift. I have to shift from the silence object to a consciousness that is observing the silence. So it can be silence, it can be thought also. Thought can rise, and I have to do see because of which I am conscious of the thought also. So it is a shifting your attention from that from which I can see. So it is same as looking at my hand, and it's not the hand, but that because of which hand is in. Without the hand, you cannot see the light there where the hand was. And therefore, to see or to recognize the light, I need the hand. To recognize the consciousness, I need an object to reflect it. I need the object, whether it can be absence of the thought or the presence of the thought. Some thought is required. Without that, I cannot recognize. So, so-called nirvikalpa samadhi, without the thought, is nothing but observation of the absence of the thought only. But I am consciousness which is observing an object called the absence of the thought. That has to be understood. So without an observing things to observe, without a reflecting medium, I cannot see the recognize the consciousness. Is it like a light? I cannot see the light unless there is a hand to reflect it. So therefore, one should have a clear understanding of this also. So for that only you have to approach appropriate teacher who is himself is Sotriyam and Brahmanishtam. Himself knows. So when Vijayaka was teaching me to observe your mind, I could not observe the mind because for that only I need to prepare the mind. That preparation itself is if it is a conditioning the mind, you are preparing is conditioning the mind, then I have to condition the mind to remove the previous conditioning, but this condition has to purify enough that it removes it along with it. That is exactly what deconditioning involves, which JK doesn't say, but that's what Vedanta says. Vedanta also agrees you are conditioning, all your vasanas is nothing but conditioning only. But you have to remove the vasanas. How do you remove the vasanas? By another vasanas? By surrendering to Him only, by through Karma Yoga, by Upasana Yoga, where it purifies the mind, and you need a soap in order to clean out the dirty plate, but in the end you don't want soap also. Soap and the dirty both have to be removed together, washed out together, leaving the plate clean. Same way the mind has to be clean. And therefore, for that, aparoksha jnanam, even the paroksha jnanam, the one is need to be done. And that is the fifth stage of the fourth stage of the spiritual progress is the paroksha jnanam. That is not enough. I should know who I am. And not only the world itself, and see Sadeva Soumya Idamagram Asid, that Sat was there before creation, and the same itself became many. Therefore, go through the analysis of the whole world. 14 lokas are created through Panchabhutas and all that. So Atmava, the Akasha Sambhutaha, Akasha, Vayu, all that is creation is involved, and these are called essentially Avantara Vakyas. They are these statements about everything about Brahman, as though Brahman is an object of knowledge. That is the Paroksha Jnanam. And the next stage of the fifth stage of evolution is Aparoksha Jnanam, where you are reading now, studying the Mahavakyas. Mahavakyas become a direct means of relating that I am and the Brahman. Brahman is the whole universe, and I am, and you are Tattvamasi statement comes into Aham Brahmasmi. I am this either Atman, this whole universe is nothing but the Brahman itself, and Atma is Brahman. All the teaching is required, and that becomes the Mahavakyas. Mahavakya means Jiva Aishwara Bodha Vakyam. That is Jiva Aishwara Aikya Bodha Vakyam is called Mahavakyam. It means these great statements where I, subject, and this, the world, are now related. I am this also, where this is, you are that essentially. That is the essence of all the universe, not the Nama Rupa. That has to be recognized, and for that only you need the fifth stage of evolution is the Aparoksha Jnanam, where I need to have a Nididhyasana, where contemplation on that knowledge, and that is the fifth stage in evolution. The sixth stage is all the Soka, because of the delusion gone, therefore the suffering is gone, because now I recognize I am holding on to that which is more permanent than the superficial entity. So the one who has completely devoted to that higher reality says Ananyas Chintayanto Ma Ejana Paryupasate Tejam Nichabhyuktanam Yogakshemam Vahamyam. He is taken care of completely, therefore he does not suffer, because he is all the time with the Ishvara only. Yomam Pasyati Sarvatra Sarvancha Mai Pasyati Tasyaham Napranasyami Sachame Napranasyati. So he is holding on to me, and therefore he is never away from me, and he is called a Jnani, and he is the greatest Bhakta also. That is the sixth stage of the evolution of realization. And the seventh stage is the recognition that I am the Ananda Swarupa, the because Aham Brahmasmi is not only understood, not only I am the existent and I am consciousness, but I am Ananda. Because I am not looking for existence, I am not looking for consciousness, because I know I exist and I know I am conscious entity. Even though I mistake myself, I am existing as this body, mind, intellect, and all that is gone. But now, not only that, I am also getting the happiness of absolute happiness, because I am my swarupam, my nature itself is happiness. The source of happiness is myself, and my mind has tuned to that. Therefore, it is not only I get the reflected happiness that everybody gets, and I get also absolute as a swarupa lakshana, because I am the very source of happiness itself. All that is gone. In that is the seventh stage of evolution, and that is the final where Aham Brahmasmi, and that's called is a Jivan Mukta. And we'll go into the more analysis of what a Jivan Mukta is. One who is firmly abiding in the knowledge that Aham Brahmasmi, and that we will be taking some Vivek Sudamani slokas again. Come back to the Vivek Sudamani and look at the Jivan Mukta status, and then we'll go and how the teaching ends, and the student's declaration later. With this, we'll stop here now. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Harihi Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.